T658, lecture 49. In the last class, we were looking at what all could go wrong with a first order continuous time delta sigma modulator, and we are looking at finite gain in the op amps. Why is attendance so poor today? Is some major event happening in campus or what?
Assignment deadline.
Okay. So we said that when we left off in the last class, we were discussing what happens when the integrator has got finite gain, and you know that finite gain is a very real thing because the integrators we had were fully differential versions of this single ended schematic, correct? And the finite gain of the op amp will result in a finite integrator gain. Okay, so if you put DC to this op amp, ideally you're supposed to get infinite voltage at the output, but that doesn't happen. So that will translate to finite DC gain in the integrator. And what will happen to the NTF therefore is on a log scale, if you plot it, this would probably be the ideal NTF. Okay. And this would be the NTF with finite gain, and what would this value be?
1/n.
Please read the axis. 20 log. Alright. Why is it 1/a? At low frequencies, the loop gain is a, and at low frequencies, we know that the NTF gain is 1 over the loop gain. So it must be 20 log 1 over a. Okay. Now, the same thing will happen to high order modulators, except that if you had, say, a third order modulator, so this is a first order example. What do you think will happen to the it's dropping much more rapidly than in the first order example. Okay, so this is the 0 dB stuff. Alright, and what will happen to the, what is this value now? Yeah, it will be minus 20 log 1 by a cube rather than 20 log 1 by a. Okay. So, if this was, you know, pi by OSR, okay, you see that there will be some hit in the in-band SNR. Alright. So there will be some degradation in the in-band SNR. Okay. And if you go and do the math, you will find that the gain requirements are actually quite modest. So as you can see, the total noise in band is basically this whole thing, okay. And where is and this is a, please mind you that this is a log plot, so where is most of the contribution coming from? It's coming somewhere here, right? So it hardly matters whether this is a small change. This is, you know, what you expect or slightly more than that. Okay, So intuitively, that's why delta sigma modulators are, especially high order ones, are actually pretty, the performance is pretty insensitive to gain errors as long as the gain is reasonably large. Okay, and for every modulator order and the oversampling ratio, you will be able to find how much gain you need before you know you start getting screwed up by a large amount. Okay, so what do you think? As the OSR decreases, do you think the gain required will decrease or increase? As the OSR decreases, the tolerance to finite gain, I mean, can you tolerate smaller gain, or do you really need all that gain in the op-amp? So you can see from this picture that if I move this dotted line towards the right, then I mean what happens here is becomes smaller and smaller of a concern. So clearly increasing the OSR basically means that you can tolerate, decreasing OSR means that you can tolerate smaller gain. Okay, does that make sense? Okay, so we are done with that. The next thing, so the op-amp can have gain, finite gain. What else can it have? What is the offset? Oh, it can have add. Okay, it can have offset. So any. All right. So, any suggestions on what you think might happen with so offset in the op-amp is equivalent to what? Okay. How does it? Where does it reflect in this model?
Input to the.
Is that clear? See. The offset to the op-amp is equivalent to adding some voltage source here, correct? So, the current, instead of being Vin by R, is Vin minus V offset by R. So, it's equivalent to replacing Vin by Vin minus V offset. Does that make sense? So, it's equivalent to replacing the integrator is not just acting on the difference between the input and the quantizer, but some offset voltage, V offset. Okay, and then the usual stuff. Alright. So, what do you think happens to, what is the effect of V offset? Pardon? What happens? I mean, the output becomes V offset. Clearly, the loop must be doing something, no? Okay, let me redraw the input this way. Okay, now. Okay, let me give you another hint. A plus B plus C is A plus B plus C, which is A plus B plus C. Okay, now can you tell me what happens? It's like adding, I mean, you can't distinguish it from? Yeah, so, it's equivalent to adding offset to the input of the modulator. Is that clear? You understand? See, please note that the input going to the integrator is basically U plus V offset minus the quantizer output, which is the same as exciting an offset free modulator with a signal of U plus V offset. So, an input offset, input referred offset of the integrator will look like an input referred offset of the modulator itself. Clear? Okay. What is, so offset SVC is not a real problem because, as we have discussed many times over, perhaps it can be gotten rid of by, you know, in many ways, and in system design it's not an issue most of the time. Okay, what else? What else can go wrong with op-amp? There's finite gain, there's offset. If somehow we manage to get rid of offset and finite gain, what would still be a problem? Finite unity gain frequency. So, what is the simplest model to account for the unity gain frequency of an integrator? For the op-amp, what model will you use? So, we use the model that we are used to doing, which is V out of the op-amp is A by 1 plus S by omega D, or A naught by 1 plus S by omega D times Vi. This is the input of the op-amp and VO is the output of the op-amp. And if as A naught tends to infinity, we see a good approximation is V naught is nothing but omega A naught omega D by S times Vi. Correct? Okay. And this is often called the gain bandwidth product of the op-amp. Is this clear? Yes, no. Okay. Now, given this, can you please tell me what happens to the integrator response? No. What happens to the integrator response? This is Vi. Let me call this Ve. This is the error voltage at the input of the op-amp. Let me call this Vi of the integrator. So, this must be minus Ve. Alright. Which, I will call this minus Ve. So, this must be equal to Vo by A, where A is GB by S. I am trying to find, to cut a long story short, I am trying to find VO versus VI when the op-amp has got some finite gain. The gain is the form GB by S. So, rather than carry GB by S all over the place, I denote GB by S by A and do the math. Okay. So, if this voltage will be minus VO by A. So, VI plus VO by A times 1 over R must be equal to minus VO by A. This is the current flowing through the capacitor times 1 over SC is the voltage across the capacitor. Minus VO by A minus this should give me VO. Does that make sense? Okay. So, Vi plus Vo by A is the voltage across R. That divided by R is the current through R. That multiplied by 1 over SC is the voltage across C. And the output voltage is the virtual ground voltage, which is minus Vo by A minus the capacitor voltage. So, that must be, this is the equation that, which basically means minus Vi by SCR must be Vo times 1 plus 1 by A plus 1 by ASCR, which implies VO by VI is minus 1 by SCR times 1 plus what is 1 by A? S by GB plus S by GB times SCR. Okay. So, the SS go away, which is, so this leads to 1 by SCR times 1 plus S, 1 plus 1 over GB times RC plus S by GB. Okay. So let me denote one, or let me denote K1 as 1 over GB times RC, okay. Alright. And please note that this is nothing but the unity gain frequency of the ideal integrator that you wish to realize. Divided by the unity gain frequency of the what? Of the op amp itself. You understand? See, the op amp based integrator behave like an ideal integrator only when the gain band product is infinity. Okay? So, this K1 is signifying the ratio of the unity gain frequency of the integrator, which is 1 over RC, okay, to the unity gain frequency of the op amp itself, which is the gain bandwidth part. Alright. Now, this means that VU by VI is approximately, is actually minus 1 by SCR times 1 plus K1 times 1 plus S by GB into 1 plus K1. Okay, so what is the effect of finite gain bandwidth? Looking at this expression, what all does this do? K1 will definitely be less than 1, okay. Okay, so one thing, one thing is that the unity gain frequency of the integrator is, first thing, what is happening? What is the equivalent unity gain frequency of this integrator if you neglect this part? Finite gain bandwidth causes two problems. One is that the unity gain frequency is changed to 1 by RC times 1 plus K1. So, do you think this unity gain frequency is smaller than the ideal one or larger? Smaller. Why does it make sense? I mean, that's what it means, right? If the system is slower, that's what.
Op amp is slow.
Yes. So what? Why does it make sense that the unity gain frequency appeared to have changed? Okay, in other words, if I put a step into an ideal integrator, I should get a ramp like this with, you know, slope 1 over RC, okay. Now, if I put a step into an integrator made with an op amp whose gain bandwidth product is finite, then what do you expect to see? You expect to see lesser slope. And why does it make physical sense? Please note that this is the op amp, okay. Finite gain of the op amp basically means that if this volt, I mean, if there is a voltage here, some voltage comes across. I mean, there you need to have a finite voltage at the negative terminal to support any non-zero voltage at the positive terminal, correct, at the output terminal. And we know that this is an inverting integrator, so if you put an a positive step here, this is going down. If this is going down, that basically means that this voltage must be positive or negative. This is an inverting op amp. The output is going negative, so the negative terminal of the op amp must be positive, right? So if this is positive, then what can you say about the current going in through the resistor? It is smaller than what it should have been in the ideal case. If the current is smaller, what happens to the voltage across the capacitor? The voltage across the capacitor is nothing but an integral of the current through the resistor, right? So the current has become smaller, clearly the voltage across the capacitor will be have a smaller slope, okay, which is basically this guy. Does that make sense? Okay, the next thing is, so it appears as if two things happening. One, the unity gain frequency of the integrator is slightly modified from the ideal value. The second thing is what? So this could basically, so then I will say, okay, so this is the so this is the ideal one. This has got a slope of 1 by RC times, this has got a slope 1 over RC, okay. So now what I need to do is to figure out what this additional thing does. What is this? What is this? An extra pole at GB times 1 plus K. Alright, and if I, so what would happen to this step response of when I add the extra pole?
Some delay.
Yeah. Yeah, so there will be a delay. Okay, and what will the delay be? It's 1 by the pole is approximately 1 over, or sorry, it is 1 over, yeah, GB times 1 plus Q. Okay. I mean, and how do I get this? This is simply nothing but ramp response of a first order circuit. Okay. Is that clear? So, there are two things happening. One, the apparent unity gain frequency of the integrator is modified, and two, there is delay. So how do you fix this? How do you fix the modification in the apparent unity gain frequency? What all ways can you think of? One way is to say, you know, if I wanted 1 over RC, I get some smaller value. So I will want, if I want something smaller to begin with, then I might get close to. In other words, if I design for this, I got this. So I'll go and try and design for this and hopefully get this. Okay? So that is one way of doing it. Another way of doing it is to say go and try and design an ideal op amp. Okay? And then but there's a limit to how, you know, how fast you can make the fundamental limit to how fast you can make the op amp if you want to, you know, burn finite amount of power. Okay? So so one way of doing it is modify RC to get the right slope, and then there is delay. So how do you fix this problem? I mean, what is the, what do you think the delay will cause? What will happen if there is delay in the integrator? Yes. Yeah, there will be a problem in the feedback loop, and this is exactly is very analogous to excess loop delay in the due to the DAC, okay, due to the quantizer. Okay, so what can you do to fix it? You can add, you know, a direct path around the quantizer, just like how whatever solution works for excess delay of the quantizer should also work for. Does it make sense? Okay. that clear? All right. So the last thing, I mean, so this is all that there is about. I mean, we had one integrator, right? What all can we do? We can make it finite gain, we can have offset and this finite speed. In practice, this GB by S, it turns out to be an oversimplification of the op-amp response. But nevertheless, you can always model, even if you took a complicated op-amp and with many poles and zeros internally, and you found the step response of that integrator, you will find that the basic, kind of response will be somewhat similar, in the sense that first the unity gain, the ideal ramp was like this. The real ramp would basically, for example, do this, okay, and all these this ringing is courtesy the extra poles inside the op amp, but you can see that the slope of the ramp is reduced with respect to the ideal ramp, okay. And once I go and redesign, let's say go and alter my RNC so that the slopes are the same, then what I would probably get is something like this, okay. And you can see that there is a delay with respect to the ideal ramp. Does make sense? And in this first order example, all these artifacts do not matter at all, because you are going to be sampling somewhere there, okay. The flash quantizer is going to be sampling somewhere here, alright. So as long as this settles well before this before the sampling instant, you can model it quite accurately as simply a delayed version of, you can model it simply like excess delay. You understand? Okay. So can you comment on what happens in higher order modulators? I mean, one thing of course is that there are more op amps, okay. So if you had a second order modulator, for example, presumably the output of this integrator is going to another integrator, all right. So do you think this initial ringing and all that matters, or it doesn't matter? Why? Yeah, so the next integrator is integrating the output of the first integrator, okay. So any artifacts in the waveform of the first integrator, will also show up as error in the subsequent integrator. Okay. So only in the first order example is all this stuff not relevant. You understand? So for compensating for finite gain bandwidth effects in the op amp involve some kind of changing of the RC time, resistor and capacitor values of the integrators, as well as fooling around with the coefficient of the direct path around the loop filter, which provides for the fast feedback paths, which make sure that the first sample coming right after the sampler is the right value. No, if you can maintain the delay constant, then in principle, yes. Yeah, so you compensate for the nominal amount of delay, and there will be variations around the delay, and you want to design things such that the modulator is stable even for variations around that minor variations around the nominal delay. Okay, so the next thing to consider . So we have seen ideal and non-idealities in the loop filter, okay, and this gives you the direct path. How do you think we will be able to implement the, so how do we get this guy, how do we get the direct path to draw a single ended schematic, this was the integrator, okay. This was the DAC, this is the input. So, VO, VC is nothing but minus V1 plus V2 by R times SC, okay. So, if V2 is, if V1 is the quantizer input and V2 is the negative of the signal that we want to digitize, then this will give you the differencing integrator that we want to generate, okay. And anyway, this is going to be realized using fully differential circuit. So, getting minus V2 and V2 is pretty straightforward, just changing the wires. Okay, now we need a direct path from, so this output is going to a quantizer, okay, and generating and then there is going to be this NRZ pulse and all this other stuff, and this is going to be V of t. This is the feedback DAC output. We need to add a direct path. So, in other words, we need to add here a volt, something which is some G times V of t, correct? This is V of t, alright. We need to add some constant times V of t at the output of the integrator. So, what do you think?
Capacitor in from virtual ground to the V of t.
Correct. So, the one way of doing this is to add, so one of these guys will go to V of t anyway, okay. Alright, and this is minus V n. So, you not only need to feed get the integral of, so please notice here, you not only need to get the integral of V of t, you also need to get something proportional to V of t, alright. The G path is the proportional path, the other path through the integrator is the integral path, okay. Here you see that this will give you the integral path, okay. You also need to generate something proportional to V of t. So, any suggestions? You put a capacitor in shunt with the, this is one way of doing it. Does it make sense? Okay. So, what is the equivalent direct path now? Pardon?
As in VT is only incrementing the shouldn't it be on the V out rather than
V of t is the output of the quantizer. Correct? This is, I mean, these two are the same node. Alright? Earlier CX wasn't there.
Sir, I didn't know why we added the CX.
Okay. No, you need to add this direct path from, I mean, why is the G there?
That is to decrease the delay.
No, it is not to decrease the delay, but it is to compensate for the excess loop delay of the in the loop due to the delay in the quantizer. Correct? So, the question was, I mean, that is a block diagram form, how do you implement that coefficient G in practice? And if you look at it carefully, it just means that V of t must come to the quantizer input not only through the proportional path through G, but also through the, I mean, not only through the integral path through the integrator, but also through a proportional path proportional to G. In practice, G for the first order modulator we saw will be equal to TD. You understand? So,
also have a resistor in
C. Wait. Okay. You understand? Is this clear?
Sir, isn't it coming to the output of the op-amp rather than, as in the V of
Yes.
The proportional part we are adding to the output of the.
We want the output of the integrator to be proportional to v of t as well as proportional to the integral of v of t. Correct? So, if you add a capacitance Cx here, the current through the capacitor is nothing but SCx times v of t. That, so in other words, the current through going into C has got two components, one which is proportional to v of t, one which is proportional to the derivative of v of t. Okay. So when you integrate this current on the capacitor, you get an integral of v of t plus the derivative and the integral get cancelled and you get something which is directly proportional. Does it make sense? Okay. So, and I mean there are many, many ways of doing this. This is just one way of doing it. Another way you could think of is, let me see, he says claim, put a resistor in series with the capacitor. That also works because an alternate way, as he points out, is to put some Rx here, all right, and get rid of the Cx. So the coefficient will be Rx by R, right? Okay, you understand?
Won't it contribute to the
Vn? Yeah, it will also contribute to the Vn. Okay, so the STF will change. It will not be the same as what you had originally intended, but definitely in the band, you will find that the STF will remain the same because in band the gain of the integrator is infinity or is very high. Alright. So, I am sure you think about it, you will be able to come up with many other ways of doing the same thing. I mean, this is a first order modulator with limited degrees of freedom, right? If you wanted, if you had a second order modulator, you would be able to, you know, find generating a proportional path is, can be done in a bazillion ways. Okay. So, this is the basic idea. Alright. So, the next thing to think about are the non-idealities in the. We have figured out all that, all the things that could go wrong here. So, stuff there is to figure out is what happens when things go wrong here. Okay. So, let me get back to the original block diagram. Okay, and as I kept saying, this is just a simplified version of the diagram. A general diagram will have a loop filter, will have some gain L0 from the input and some gain L1 from the feedback path. In this example, for I mean in these examples, simply for instead of I mean in order to avoid drawing two paths, I have just used the two to be the same. So this is U, this is V, and this is the quantizer, which I will remind you again is nothing but an ADC. This is the digital output and this is the DAC. Does it make sense? Okay. So, things could be go wrong in the ADC, things could go wrong in the DAC, things could go wrong with the sampling. Okay. And please note the ADC sampling instant is governed by, I mean the sampling is usually internal to the ADC. So, this is governed by some clock. Alright. And the DAC will update at beginning another clock edge, and the difference between these two clock edges is the equivalent delay of the quantizer. Does it make sense? The first the ADC will sample, push out the bits, the DAC will look at those bits and put out an analog waveform. Correct? So the time at which the DAC begins to put out the analog waveform has to be after the ADC has sampled. Right? And the difference is the excess loop delay whose effects we have seen earlier. Now, As you know, the ADC is not perfect. There are comparators, and you know, these comparators have random offsets that you have seen already. Okay, so random offsets in the ADC is equivalent to what? What do you think? How do you think I should be able to model this non-ideality in the ADC? The output of the ADC is a digital form. There is no voltage at the output of the ADC. Where? Pardon? Yeah. See, please note that we have modeled the step-like response of the ADC, okay, by adding some equivalent input noise source. Correct? So now you say the thresholds are shifted away from the ideal values that you thought you had due to random offset. So you can always find some waveform that you must add at the input of the ADC. Okay, so E1 of n. Alright? I mean, see, any deviation from the ideal, you can always think of it as adding an error. Okay? Alright? So conceptually, you can think of the modified thresholds as adding some more noise. Okay? So what do you think will happen to this noise? What is the response from that input of the ADC to the NTF? It is nothing but the NTF. So non-idealities on the ADC side due to random mismatch in the comparator thresholds, okay, can be modeled equivalently by some noise E1 of n, and this gets noise shaped out of the signal band because of the variation of the loop. So this is exactly, instead of having the original quantization noise, it's now like having some other weirdo waveform, right, which anyway gets shaped. Okay, so the ADC comparator offsets are noise shaped out of the signal band.
But E1 of n will be correlated with it.
Pardon?
E1 of n will be correlated.
Yeah, so is E of n, the original quantization noise.
To what extent?
Pardon?
Does it affect it?
Yeah, you run simulations and find out. Okay. Alright, I mean, the complaint is that E1 of n will be correlated with the input, sure, so is E of n, the original quantization noise, okay. So it hardly matters if, you know, I mean, there's nothing fantastically, you know, there's nothing you have to get fantastically perturbed about, because we have been doing this all along, okay. Alright, so when you make so many wrong assumptions, it doesn't hurt to make one more, as I say, okay. Alright, the next one, of course, is the next culprit in the loop is the DAC. What happens? The DAC is made with unit current sources or unit resistors or whatever. Alright, so what do you think happens in a real DAC? There will be mismatch in the currents or the resistors. Okay, so in other words, the LSB of the LSB size of the DAC will not be the same depending on the, I mean, independent of the code. We have seen how mismatch can cause DNL and INL in the DAC, correct? So, so going by this argument, what can I now model the mismatch in the DAC as? So, what I will do is model the Alright. And please note that EDAC of T is simply coming because of mismatch in the DAC unit elements. Does it make sense? Okay. So if there is mismatch in the DAC unit elements, there is some noise, like, I mean, there is some waveform that you can add to the output of an ideal DAC and model this effect. So what do you think will happen to EDAC? What is the transfer function from EDAC to the output?
STF.
It is simply the STF, because you cannot distinguish from input. Alright. So EDAC of T cannot be distinguished from the input. So what do you think will happen? Ideally, you were expecting to see a noise shaped spectrum at the output like this. All right. And now the spectrum will be the ideal spectrum plus the spectrum of EDAC, okay, which is some random noise stuff, okay, some random stuff depending on the exact errors due to mismatch and so on. So it will of course be a fantastic stroke of luck if it turns out that EDAC of T has got no components in the signal band, and quite expectedly EDAC of T does turn out to have a lot of components inside the signal band. Okay, one way you can think of it is the following. Ideally all these guys, the outputs of the DAC are supposed to lie on a straight line as you go on increasing the code. Now what is happening for some codes, the outputs are the red dots, okay, there is a slight difference between the ideal waveform and the real waveform, okay. So you can think of this, so if I put in a sine wave sequence at the input to the DAC, at the output I will get the sine wave plus some error sequence, okay, with and if the sine wave is periodic, what can you say about this error sequence? It will also repeat again, okay. So clearly please note that the output of the modulator is sine wave plus shape noise, okay. So there is definitely a sine wave component in the output, so this will kind of repeat, okay, which means what does it mean? If this is periodic with period, with the signal period, what happens? It will cause distortion, correct, okay.
Also periodic like this.
Correct. So there is not only the signal, but there is also quantization noise, okay. The quantization noise will go through, ideally you are supposed to go through this a straight line, okay. Now what happens? It goes through, some kind of polynomial type transfer characteristic, which is something like that, okay. So if you take a noise process and pass it through a weak nonlinearity, it will turn out that components at two frequencies can get multiplied and appear at a third frequency. If you take, ideally what happens, the quantization noise, the shape quantization noise has got a spectrum like this, right. So there is no spectrum at low frequency, there is no components at low frequency. But let us say I took this noise and passed this through a linearity of the form x square. If I just simply squared this noise, what do you think will happen? You understand? So the question is the following. I take noise having this spectrum, the noise has got no components at low frequency, okay. I take this and just square this waveform, alright, and plot the spectrum here. What do you think should happen? Square. See, you can think of this as a sum of sine waves, okay, of different strengths at each frequency, correct? So if I take the sum of two sine waves and pass it through a squarer, what do you think will happen? I will get a component at twice f1, twice f2 and twice of, and I'm saying f1 plus f2 and f1 minus f2. So two components here, what is the difference between their their frequencies? Is very small. So the moment I pass it through a nonlinearity, something will happen at low frequencies, which is dependent on these amplitudes, correct? So this is just to illustrate that if you take some process like this and pass it through an arbitrary nonlinearity, what do you think will happen to the stuff at low frequency? Stuff from all over the place will fold back into the low frequencies. So what will happen at the output is that this whole thing will get filled up and you probably see some, okay. So if you had a notch in the beginning, you know, you will definitely not see a notch at the after you pass the noise process through a nonlinearity, because you can model the noise as a bunch of sine waves at different frequencies, and once you pass a sum of sinusoids through a nonlinearity, you will get a whole bunch of new frequency components which are, you know, harmonically related to f1. I mean, if you take a sine wave of frequency f1 and a sine wave of frequency f2 and pass it through an mth order nonlinearity, you will get all frequencies which are k1 f1 plus k2 f2, where k1 and k2 are integers. It will go and multiply, okay, you understand. So that's pretty much what happens here, okay. So there is this shape quantization noise which goes through a nonlinear transfer characteristic corresponding to the D2A converter because of mismatch, and here I have exaggerated greatly, but in practice, you know, the mismatch will be very small. But please note that we are trying to reach, you know, hit very very high signal to noise ratios in the signal band, okay. So a small amount of noise from out of band getting pushed into in band due to nonlinearity is all that it takes to screw up the performance of a modulator. So DAC nonlinearity, or rather nonlinearity in the DAC due to mismatch of components going to make up the DAC, is not noise shaped, okay, in the loop, because it appears like adding an error at the input. Second, the ADC quantizer mismatch effects are, it's a lot more benign to the mismatch in the thresholds inside the comparators of the ADC, that effect is a lot more benign because that stuff is getting shaped out of the loop, okay. So this mismatch in DACs, and how to get rid of, we have to do something about it, right. So it doesn't make sense to have to require, the whole idea in doing a delta sigma was that you could use a cheap lousy quantizer and get phenomenal resolution, okay. But now if you say, you need only a 4 level DAC or a 16 level DAC, but the output of the DAC must absolutely lie on a straight line, otherwise you don't, this whole thing is bust, and there's no point doing this, right. So I'll show you some simulation results tomorrow to, you know, give you an idea of what happens in practice when there is DAC mismatch and what you can do about it, okay. All right.